Hello students, today we will discuss about licensing of trademarks and registered users. You guys must love to go out and eat in fast food restaurants like Pizza Hut and KFC. They only exist because of trademark licensing. So every time you enjoy a meal at such restaurants, you should thank trademark licensing. The most significant difference between a trademark, copyright, or patent is the inherent property right that exists once the work or the invention comes into existence. On the other hand, a brand, symbol, or logo, or word don't have in it any inherent property right. It is, in fact, derived by the association of such symbols with certain goods and the goodwill created by such association. However, since originally the sole function of trademark was considered as identification of the source, both in UK and USA. Thus, trademark and goodwill of business was considered inseparable, and assignment of trademark without goodwill was considered not feasible. This state of law caused considerable hardships and now has been changed as discussed in the last lecture. The Goshen Committee reported that such a theory based on goodwill governing assignment was no longer universally correct. They accepted the commercial view that the goodwill of a business is inherent in the trademark itself, and thus UK and USA began to accept assignment without goodwill. This revelation slowly paved way for lessening of the relevance of the source, provided the proprietor exercised sufficient control over the quality of the goods. Now, regimes related to assignment and licensing of trademark in India has been quite liberalized, and like assignment, even licensing of unregistered marks is permitted. So, what is licensing of trademarks? Licensing of trademarks basically refers to a process where registered proprietor of a trademark authorizes a third party, known as licensee, to use the concerned brand name in the course of trade, either on an exclusive basis or non-exclusive basis, thereby permitting the licensee to commercially exploit the trademark. So, what is the benefit of licensing to the registered proprietor? The registered proprietor makes money by earning royalty in exchange of such use. Royalty is generally a fixed percentage of revenue generated by licensee, but can be a lump sum amount as well. It all depends upon the contract between the registered proprietor and the licensee. Though the terms like licensing or license is nowhere found in the Trademarks Act, the statutory provisions governing the law related to trademark licensing in India is contained in sections 48 to 55. Wherein licensees are actually referred as registered users. Since the scope and purpose of certification trademarks is different and distinct from ordinary trademarks, the provisions concerning registration of registered user are not applicable to certification trademarks, whose main purpose is to show that the goods on which the certification trademark is used have been certified by some competent person in respect of certain characteristics such as origin, mode of manufacture, quality, etc. Section 48, subsection of the Trademarks Act provides that any person other than a registered proprietor may be registered as registered user of a trademark in respect of all or any goods or services in respect of which the trademark is registered. This licensing is usually by way of an explicit contract that must be accompanied with the application for registration. This agreement should disclose terms as to royalty, means for bringing permitted use to an end, etc. The permitted use of the trademark shall be deemed to be used by the proprietor for the purposes of Section 47, which deals with rectification of trademarks for non-use. The term permitted use, as defined under the Trademarks Act 1999, entails the use of the registered mark by a third party with the consent of the registered proprietor by way of a written agreement or as a registered user. It should, however, be noted that such licensing should not result in causing confusion among the public or destroy the distinctiveness of the trademark. In order to achieve this, licensing of trademark by the proprietor should be subject to strict conditions and requirements as to ensure that the link between the source of the trademark and the goods or services on which the trademark is being used is maintained. So far as a connection in a course of trade with the trademark continues to exist between the goods and the proprietor of the mark, the goodwill accruing out of such use shall get routed back to the licensor. This link can be maintained by adoption of certain measures, such as appropriate trademark signifiers, references to the extent that the mark is being used under license, quality control, and by maintaining and protecting the licensed trademark against third parties by the licensor. In the event that a licensor uses the trademark as a commodity without establishing a trade connection between the licensor and the product, the goodwill arising out of such use may accrue to the licensee. In such a situation, and in case of a dispute between the licensor and the licensee shall be able to challenge the validity of the licensed trademark, submitting the plea that the trade connection between the licensor and the licensed trademark is missing, and that's why the licensee has acquired rights over the trademark. And the licensed trademark is now pointing toward two sources, which is forbidden under law. In Bark America International USA Trust versus Tyfield Importers Incorporated at Alia, the Bark American company had marketing rights in the UK for wines. They had registered the trademark that later expired, and after which they licensed it to another company by a written agreement. The agreement did not grant Bark America the right to quality control over the licensee's production of wine. A foreign company wanted to cancel this trademark for the purpose of selling their wine under the same name and hence put in an application for the same. The court held that uncontrolled or naked licensing may result in trademark ceasing to function as a symbol of quality and controlled source. Consequently, where the licensee fails to exercise adequate quality control over the licensee, a court may find that the trademark owner has abandoned the trademark, in which case the owner would be stopped from asserting rights to the trademark. Now we will discuss the procedure for recording the registered user, where it is proposed that the person is to be recorded as a registered user of a trademark. The registered proprietor and the proposed user will have to make an application jointly to the registrar on form TM28 together with prescribed fees. Ordinarily, the joint application should be made to the registrar soon after the parties entered into an agreement and the agreement is signed or executed. However, sub rule 4 of rule 80 provides that no applications shall be entertained unless the same has been filed within 6 months from the date of the agreement. Under the earlier law, the period was 18 months from the date of the agreement. The procedure for recording of registered user can be divided into 8 steps. So the first step is filling out TM28. TM28 should be filed in triplicate and it must be accompanied by following documents. First is agreement in writing between the registered proprietor and the proposed user, or duly authenticated copy thereof with respect to the permitted use of the trademark. Second is document and correspondence, if any, mentioned in the agreement or authenticated copies thereof. Third is supporting affidavit of the registered proprietor or some authorized person testifying to the genuineness of the documents accompanying the applications. What all particular should be mentioned in the supporting affidavit will be discussed in the next step. Lastly, such other or further documents, evidence or information as the registrar may call upon. Where more than one application for registration as registered user is made by the same registered proprietor and the same proposed registered user in respect of different trademarks covered by same agreement, the documents may be filed with any one of the application and a cross-reference to such documents can be given in other application or applications. So the second step is drafting supporting affidavit. While drafting supporting affidavit, you should ensure that it contains following things. First is giving particulars of the precise relationship existing or proposed between the registered proprietor and the proposed registered user, like for instance, whether the relationship is as a holding or subsidiary company or as a principal and agent, etc. The second thing you should ensure is particulars showing the degree of control by the proprietor over the permitted use and whether it is a term of their relationship that the proposed registered user shall be the sole registered user or that there can be other registered users as well. Third is stating the goods or services in respect of which registration is proposed. Fourth is stating the conditions or restrictions, if any, proposed with respect to the characteristics of the goods or services, to mode or place of permitted use or any other matter. Fifth and last thing you should ensure is stating whether the permitted use is to be for a particular period or till perpetuity, and if the use is for a period, then duration thereof. The third step is ensuring that the license agreement contains all the essential particulars. In general commercial practice, license agreement is first executed and then an application is filed for recording the registered user. However, before attaching the license agreement with DM28, it is advisable to ensure that the agreement contains all the relevant particulars required under the Trademarks Act, rules made therein and the practice of concerned trademark registry. This avoids the danger of application being rejected because the license agreement don't fulfill the necessary criteria. In general, the license agreement must include following things. First, it should provide all the particulars mentioned in the supporting affidavit. Second, it should disclose the terms of royalty and other remuneration payable by the user to the registered proprietor for the permitted use of the trademark. Third, it should provide means for bringing the permitted use to an end when the relationship between the parties or the control by the registered proprietor over the permitted user ceases. The fourth step is filing the application. TM28 can be filed online as well as offline. The process of filing the application offline is pretty simple. After filling out the relevant form and attaching the supporting documents, you send it to the registry having jurisdiction over that application under a cover letter, either through post or by hand. How to file applications online has already been discussed in the lecture solely dedicated to this topic. So the fifth step is conditional acceptance. When the registrar receives an application, he has two options. First, to accept it completely. Second, to accept it conditionally. When the registrar proposes to accept the application subject to any conditions, restrictions or limitation, he or she will issue a notice in writing to the applicants stating the grounds on which he or she proposes to issue such orders. The sixth step is hearing. On a notice issued by the registrar, the parties may apply for a hearing. The registrar may then appoint time for the hearing within 2 months and shall give them not less than a month's notice of the time so appointed. In the light of the hearing, the registrar may decide whether to accept the application or accept it conditionally or refuse the application altogether. The registrar will communicate his or her order in writing to the applicants and to other registered users of the mark, if any. On the other hand, if the parties don't apply for a hearing within 1 month from the receipt of the notice, the registrar may accept the application subject to those conditions or limitations mentioned in the notice. The power of the registrar to refuse an application is just an enabling one and will be exercisable only where the parties do not agree to the conditions or limitations. It may also arise in a rare case where the registered proprietor has already granted an exclusive license to a party and, in contravention of the terms of such license, is proposing to appoint another licensee. So the seventh step is entry in the register. Where an application is accepted for registration, the registrar will record the proposed registered user as a registered user in the register for trademarks. When registered, the date on which the application was made will be deemed to be the date of the registration as registered user. The eighth and last step is notification to other registered users, if any, and publication. After recording a registered user, the registrar will issue a notice in the prescribed manner of the fact of registration of such person as a registered user to every other registered users of the trademark, if any. The registrar will also ensure that this fact is inserted in the trademark journal within 3 months of such entry in the register. With this, the lecture comes to an end. I hope you found this lecture useful. If you still have any doubts or queries about this lecture, please feel free to contact us on doubts@fusionlawschool.com. Thanks for watching. Hi viewers, to know more about us, please visit fusionlawschool.com or you can also visit us on Facebook, Twitter or Google+. Links are provided here. To stay updated, subscribe to our YouTube channel by clicking on the subscribe button. If you like this video, please like, share and comment down below.